Friends, welcome to Mount Bethel Presbyterian Church video worship for this July 4th, 2021. I'm Marguerite Sarine, the transitional pastor here at Mount Bethel in Durham, North Carolina, and I'm delighted that you have taken some time out of your holiday to remember not just country, but God. Let us worship.
Jesus Christ, the crucified Lord, calls us to believe the good news of salvation. His grace is sufficient for us. Let us enter into God's new realm rejoicing, not in our own strength, but in the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us worship God. Threats to life pierce us and cause us to doubt God's love, but God shows love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let us confess our sins and receive new life. We'll begin with a moment of silent and individual confession, followed by our corporate prayer. Dear Lord, hear the prayers of our hearts, and hear us now as we pray together, saying, Holy Three, Holy One, Triune God, we confess that we do not believe that you have overcome sin and death. We are more in touch with the pangs of our weakness than we are with the power of your love. In fear, we worship idols. In despair, we collapse in holiness. In rage, we seek to dominate others. O God of David, forgive us. O Son of David, have mercy on us. O Spirit of the living God, grant us peace. Let us out with the good news. Nothing can withstand the victory of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Hear and believe this good news. Jesus, the Christ, Son of Mary, Son of the Most High God, was broken and poured out for our salvation. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen.
Our lectionary reading this morning is the epistle reading for this Sunday in Ordinary Time from our friend, the Apostle Paul. It's his second letter to the church in Corinth. I'm reading from chapter 12, beginning at verse 2. And here in this defense that Paul is writing, a bit of a comeuppance for the Corinthian church and how they evaluate spiritual gifts and people's stories of God's revelation in their lives and whether or not that makes them more credible. Listen now to this holy word of God for us this morning. Paul writes, "I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard such things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except in my weaknesses. For if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations that Paul said that he had 14 years ago. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given to me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me, but he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness.' So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Whew! Well, that is quite a passage coming to us this morning, and yet it is quite an appropriate passage for July 4th, the anniversary of that day when a bunch of elected representatives from 13 British colonies in North America finally were too hot to be any more hot and bothered by the disagreements they had about the wording of a document they called the Declaration of Independence. So they voted to adopt it warts and all and began a country that today is reckoning with that beginning, with that document, and with the stories that we've told ourselves over the last 200 plus years about what it all means. Are we as good as we have said we are? Are we as bad as some of us may fear we are? Which story about America is true? We are grappling with the question, what does it even mean to be American? We have never grappled before. And on this very day, the lectionary brings us this passage from Paul's second letter to Corinth, a church founded in their new Christian faith by an apostle who shared with them the wrestling over whether they were as good as they wanted to think they were, or as bad as they feared they were, and what that meant for themselves and their relationships with everyone else. The Corinthians were grappling with the question, what does it mean to be a Christian? And in Paul's wonderfully sarcastic, slightly impatient, and then unexpectedly grace-filled letter, he sums up the dilemma beautifully. We are neither as good as we like to think we are, nor as we are as bad as we fear we are, and even more important than that, neither is anyone or anything else as good as we like to think it is, or as bad as we fear it is. In Paul's theology, God makes sure that we have a thorn in our side that keeps us from being too elated, from falling too much in love with ourselves, especially as it regards our ideas of God and our theology. And then God makes sure that we are given gifts, even for some of us, for gifts of divine revelation, so that even we who have thorns in our sides can participate in some small way, bringing in God's kingdom of justice, love, and peace for the kingdom, for everyone and everything, not just ourselves. But we do that not by prideful insistence that our gifts are the gift. We do that by recognizing the thorn in our side that keeps us from being too elated with ourselves and grounded in the reality that we, like every other human being, like every situation in the world faces, are not as wonderful as we might think when we idealize them, and are not as awful as we think when we demonize them. We just have a part to play as a gift. We are not the gift. And in understanding, that's what it means to be a Christian, that it's as much as understanding the need not to be too elated, as it is to have divine revelations that might mean the very salvation of the world and think that we are God's gift to the world, that Paul tries to impart in this sometimes difficult to understand passage. He's telling the Corinthians that because of their new faith and the people that have come to them saying that God has divinely revealed the very divine self, so they're the real apostles in the room. They are trying to figure out, well, is this the person that we need to idealize? Or is this person trying to pull something over on us? And they thought that about Paul. So we need to sort of demonize this person. Paul wanted the Corinthians to understand that nobody, even Paul, would be as good or as bad as they thought, and that this is the authentic journey to find that authentic way where the thorn in the side keeps us from being too elated with ourselves, but that God's grace and God's gift keeps us from being too despairing about ourselves. So those brothers and sisters of our Christian faith who see nothing but glory in being a Christian, sure of their sense of right and wrong, so sure of it that everybody else needs to live the way that they think they should because they have a divine revelation saying that, Paul would warn them that they too have a thorn in the flesh, whether they admit it or not. And we see very frequently that those who do not admit it can end up in the headlines for embezzlement or abuse or having some sort of inappropriate relationship with people that they should not have an inappropriate relationship with. And does that mean they're not Christians? Well, I don't think Paul would say that, but he would say that they're not being authentic Christians until they come to see that they are not to be too elated with themselves, so they don't fall into that trap, nor are they to be despairing and fearful about their sins, to hold at bay either of these judgments of themselves and everybody else, is to live in the reality of human ambiguity in this life and the confessional attitude that because of that reality, it is only by the grace of God, God's grace, that must be sufficient for us. It's the only ground we have to stand on that will not eventually give way underneath our feet. God's grace, which comes to us in the understanding of why Jesus Christ is Lord and we are not, nor is our neighbor, nor are the people that we're afraid of. And so we come back to the story of our country's birth as the controversy over the New York Times 1619 Project and critical race theory continue in very close to home for us right here in central North Carolina as UNC's School of Journalism continues to struggle over whether to offer tenure to the author of that piece, Nicole Hannah Jones. There would be no controversy if we all agreed on what America is. We've always claimed American exceptionalism. We were a chosen people to be a city, a beacon on a hill. Professor Hannah Jones claims we are only exceptional because of black enslaved labor that built the foundations of this country, allowing it to fulfill that role. Now that's a different story of who America is than the one many of us grew up with and takes us back to that July 4th, 1776, when the absence of air conditioning and the blistering summer in Philadelphia probably had more to do with the birth of our country than any consensus around Jefferson's ideas in the Declaration of Independence. And since then, this country has seen arguments between those who thought that we were better than we were, and those who thought that we were worse than we feared. And what Paul would ask us, I think, is not which side we're on or which side we think is right. What Paul would ask us is which side admits that it has some of the truth, but not all of the truth. When have we been as good as we always hoped we were? When have we been as awful as our worst critics have claimed? These are the questions that lead us to the reality of Paul's thorn in the flesh. We're never as good as we think we are. We do not need to be too elated, but we still have a calling from God to show what it is to live authentic, hopeful, and helpful life in accepting that truth, to wrestle with that truth, to resist the simplistic calls that think an entire country could be defined as good, any more than an entire person could be defined as good. We must resist that simplistic call, which we do, by the way, each Sunday when we have a prayer of confession. We resist the simplistic call that because we sit in church, we are good. Paul would have us realize that none of us, black, white, American, Chinese, or anyone else, occupy the moral high ground, no matter what our own moral standard is or anyone else's. Only God's grace occupies that high ground for Paul. That is our only moral high ground, God's grace, which reminds us that we are not as good as we hope we are. And because of God's grace, we are not trapped by how bad we've been. In this continuing balancing act of being true about all that's good and all that's a thorn in our flesh tormenting us, we live as authentic human beings who may happen to be Americans or Christians. But those labels define us less than God's grace to redeem everything about us that we wish we had not done. And God's grace to keep us from being too elated about what we think we've done that's so wonderful. As we can become balanced about both of those things, we too, with Jesus, can calm the storm over whose story is right, over who's good, over who's bad, and instead redefine the story as being at peace with the truth that's in both the thorn in the flesh and the redemption from God, and use our knowledge, our peace about the imperfections in ourselves and the imperfections in our institutions that continue to call us into the conversation. How can God's kingdom of justice, peace, and love come into this situation, into this people? Paul found a way to inspire us to find and follow that way as well. With God's help and only by God's grace. Happy July 4th. But don't be too elated. Amen. Friends, we come before God with nothing but ourselves and what is in our hearts. And friends, it's not as bad as we fear it is, nor is it as good as we might think it is. All God asks is for us to offer our own selves and our own lives in the service of God's kingdom. So in that authentic request for our authentic selves, let us offer what we truly feel called to give.
Let us now bring thoughts and prayers for God's people to God. Bow with me. God of heaven and earth, creator of all things, seen and unseen, we join with the church through all ages, praying that you cast out all evil and renew the face of the whole creation. Grant wisdom and courage to the political leaders, so they can enact in every nation, for the common good, the justice you command. We pray this day for all who have been suffering at the hands of the violent and power-hungry, the greedy and malicious, the ignorant and misguided, and the powers of evil beyond human control. May each one of you who is afflicted find comfort in your faith, hope and love to enable them to overcome. We pray that you will complete the renewal you begin in raising Jesus from the dead, giving us new life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, peace be with you. The peace that comes from knowing that all the vicissitudes of life, all the vicissitudes of our feelings and emotions can swirl about us and come and go up and down. And God provides us the solid ground on which we stand by showing us the grace of Jesus Christ again and again and whenever we need it, even though we never deserve it. So that is who we are. That is who God is. And on this day, as we celebrate our country and mourn its shortcomings, find your solid ground on God's grace. By the power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.